Well, the Greeks held that the visual arts were the imitation of life, but the computer arts are the imitation of creation itself. Thank you very much.
At the last gasp of this conference, and it's going to be my pleasure to introduce Stu Card and Tom Moran. Let me do it the following way. You know, there are many ingredients. We've been talking about them, and several people here have tried to mention the kind of dimensions we've got, the sort of process and memory one, the graphics, the networking, lots of different dimensions, all of which add up into this notion of the personal workstation. The people that pushed these areas were fundamentally technologists, and the story we've got here is really the story of a technology development. Sometimes, as in the stuff that Jan Schultz just described, but also the stuff that Wes Clark was talking about, or even the stuff that that we saw in the Color Freed thing, there is in fact an area of application that's very strong in that. That is the issue of this particular medical thing, the issue of the neurosciences or the physicists. There's an area of application that's driving it as well as just the technology. There is also a person in this interface, as you are all aware. And in some respects, I mean, as one looks at this area, the issue of the psychology of the human and what we know about that has not, in fact, played a very large role. It's played a fairly muted role. Now, a muted role doesn't mean it's played no role at all. And in fact, you can see in the things we've had in this conference the ways in which it's happened. For instance, you can look at Doug Engelbart's stuff, and clearly Doug has and presented to us a real notion that focused on what the human was doing. The key element for me in that is that the limiting channel is really the motor channel, and as he does very effectively, and I can't do so effectively, if we could just get it all going all at the same time, then we'd in fact really allow that human to communicate with the machine. And there is in fact a model there. You can see it in some of Alan Kay's stuff. You can see it also in Licklider. I don't know if most of you knew, but Licklider is in fact a psychologist, cut his teeth on that in psychoacoustics. And in fact, in Lick's talk, he kept dropping back to little pieces of data about human behavior in these situations that come out of the human factors world that he knew about and most of you didn't know about. And one of the things I got out of that part of his talk was that very often he was sort of disappointed in terms of what actually turned out. It didn't quite turn out the way you thought it was going to, or you couldn't understand when they would wake up and realize that that's what the data said. But that's what you get for being a psychologist in this field, I guess. It seems to me that although the issue of the nature of the human in the interface and what we know about it is certainly not the central driver in this thing, telling some of the parts of that story are also part of the history, and that's really what's going on with the part of the park story that relates to Tom and Stu. And I thought that I might just take one half second, since I've been involved in that a little bit, and sort of set the context a little bit and tell the very early part of that historical story, because it turns out that I got introduced to park very early, and it was actually in December of 1970, when I came out here and talking with George Paik and Bob Taylor. And I came out here and spent 3 months not there, but sitting up at Stinson Beach just on a mini sabbatical. But out of that came the notion, just in talking over those 3 months, came the notion that maybe one was really able to start down to learn something about how humans really interacted with these machines and to build some serious models. We talked about it as the time was ripe to apply cognitive psychology to this sort of an applied field. Still required a lot of research, but one ought to start down that path and do more research to make an applied cognitive psychology. Now, one of the things that hasn't been strong, only reflected in Lick's own comments, is, of course, there is this long history of work in human factors. Not much in evidence except for Lick's comments in this whole development that we've been seeing. But that idea sort of took root at that time, and then nothing happened for a couple of years until all of a sudden two students showed up. All of a sudden, graduate students never show up all of a sudden. They start, but then they hang around for years. But two graduate students, Stuart in psychology, actually an interdisciplinary program between psychology and computers called the Systems and Communication Sciences Program, and Tom Moran working in computer science. Both of those students with an interest in this area, that is both artificial intelligence and cognitive psychology and the nature of human interaction. And we went through a negotiation with Xerox PARC about whether we really ought to go down that path. And one of the beautiful things about that environment at that time was that clearly wasn't in some sense in the main line of their path, but it was a very flexible organization, and they kind of included that in. And we set up a kind of an agreement that we would go try and do the research to set up what we called an applied information processing psychology that would focus on the nature of human behavior in these situations. Then one of those peculiar things happened, which is always doing the right thing for the wrong reason. And because of some little internal matters which make no difference now, instead of doing what we all thought we would be doing, which is to study how humans program, which we'd done if we'd have gotten into CSL, we moved over into the system sciences because that's where this polo system was going. And instead, we shifted our attention to the nature of how people actually interacted with editing systems. And that really then set the problem, for kind of irrelevant reasons to begin with, set the problem that we then focused on for the next several years. And so with that, maybe I will let Stu and Tom take over and tell some more pieces of that story and how it relates to the rest of what PARC was doing. They're going to kind of split the time. So Stu, I guess, is going to talk first, and then Tom, and then I'll come back and we'll close out the session with some comments from Al Perlis. Stu?
Can you grab my notes?
Sure. I'll even give them to you.
In this conference, we've seen over and over again how the technology of personal workstations has been driven by a kind of generic vision. This vision involves people somehow in tight coupling doing significant intellectual work. The projects that have taken steps in this direction have been led, therefore, to make major advances in human-computer interaction of one sort or another. And gradually, these advances have begun to accumulate slowly into a kind of user technology. Can I have the first slide, please? Parts to it. One part is mice and bitmap displays and windows and these hardware and software advances that you've seen and that have been described in some detail in other parts of the conference. But there's another part of user technology, too. User technology that consists of an understanding of the user, the things that Al was talking about, that we needed. Butler said doing user interfaces is hard. And what you need to do in order to conquer that problem is first you need to just design lots and lots of interfaces so you gradually accumulate those things. But you also need to try and get some understanding of just why it is that some of those things work and some of those things don't work. And that's the part that Tom and I are going to talk about this afternoon. How we came to understand, or the extent to which we came to understand more of that side of the user technology of the users. Well, as Al said, the most relevant organized body of information was the human factors literature when we began this. Now, there's lots of interesting things in the human factors literature, but a lot of it tends to involve the sensory motor operations on dials and what kind of keyboards to have and that sort of thing. But the interaction with computers of the sort that's required for the grand vision that many people have is intensely cognitive. And so by itself, it's really not sufficient. And our great hope was that we could create a science of the user rooted in some sort of cognitive theory. But we wanted it also to be practical, so that real things would happen. So although there's a certain amount of an academic exercise in this, we purposely tried to site it in an industrial laboratory so that the pressures of real practical things would always apply. And there's four, there's various strands of this, but I'd like to organize them for purposes of presentation into largely four strands, four ways of looking at the interface. First, the physical interface, the mouse, the keyboards, that sort of thing. Secondly, the cognitive interface, those parts where the information processing characteristics of the user itself begin to enter into considerations. Third, the conceptual interface, those areas where we start to get into understanding the model the user has of what he is doing. Fourth, the task interface. I guess this is what Doug Gross called the personal work aspect, or the left side of Engelbart's chart, where we go over into the task itself to sort of figure out what is to be done. Well, when we last left Bill English, he was happily employed, being sort of the genius of Engelbart's lab that helped to make things work out. Well, English and a number of other people from Engelbart's lab came over to Park. Tom and I first began our career at Park working for English. Both Engelbart and English had always considered the mouse sort of an interim device to do until they could think of something better. English in particular had something that he wanted to do to improve the mouse. Sometimes we had dialects of NLS running in our laboratory, and sometimes, even though it was a very good system, when you would look at the users using NLS, it would look like they were about to fly. And so English came up with this idea of putting a key on the keyboard that would secretly be an isometric joystick, so you wouldn't have to move your hands, and you just move the key a little bit, and it could move the cursor around. And he tried. So he built a number of devices. There's that knob is the key I'm talking about, a functional prototype thereof. He did a number of keys, and we helped him design the experiment and ran the experiment to see if any of these would be better than a mouse. And lo and behold, the mouse still won. As you see, the error rate is lowest for the mouse. The time is fastest for the mouse. But this is just a typical human factors experiment. And what we wanted to do is we wanted to go beyond the methodology of human factors experiments. We wanted to know why it is that one of these devices is better. We wanted to know why the mouse is better than the other device. And so for that reason, we set out to do mathematical modeling of the different devices. And the model for the mouse is really the most interesting one. This shows that the time to move the mouse is given by what's called Fitts' law. Now, the interesting thing about that is that Fitts' law is the law which also governs the movement of the hand. And not only that, but the 10 bits per second slope constant you see here is also approximately the same as you get for the hand. And now, what that meant is that really it wasn't the mouse that was the limitation in how fast you could select the target, that the limitation wasn't in the mouse, but it was in the eye-hand coordination system of the human himself. And what that meant was that the mouse was close to being an optimal device, And what that meant was that, at least using the same set of muscles, you weren't likely to invent a device that went any faster than the mouse. You could probably get a number of them that were about the same, but you wouldn't likely get one that was much faster. So this was a kind of example of the sort of theory that we were looking for. It's precise enough to allow a designer to make a back-of-the-envelope calculation. It identified some of the key constraints. As long as you keep the ratio of the distance you move the mouse to the size of the target constant, it's going to take you a constant amount of time to point. So it even tells you if you want to have targets that are far away from where the mouse is going to be, so you're going to have a long movement, you better make the targets larger. It tells you by exactly how much the target ought to be bigger if it's a certain distance away. I carry these results down to a set of Xerox engineers in Los Angeles who were busy trying to invent devices that were better than the mouse, and told them they weren't likely to succeed. They received this news less than enthusiastically, but they never did succeed, of course. And these results were heavily used within the systems development department of Xerox in deciding to actually go with the mouse on the first product that they came out with. Well, an interesting result of the mouse study was a way in which the evaluation of the pointing device, a sensory motor device, actually led to a consideration of human information processing characteristics. This experience pointed out the need for a kind of engineering model of the human that you could think with. In the human factors and psychological literature, the literature is basically badly disorganized and contradictory and whatever. Psychologists love to split hairs and often miss some larger generalizations that approximately hold and could be useful practically. And when we finally, we had the notion early on, we finally got around to it later, to trying to do something about that, and our version was a thing called the Model Human Processor. The Model Human Processor was partly inspired by the processor's memory and switches, the PMS notation of Bell and Newell. That inspired me. Newell claims it didn't inspire him. And what we made was a kind of simplified architecture of human information processing. There's three processors, four memories, 19 parameters of these, and 10 things we call principles of operation. The processors had cycle time parameters, and the memory had capacity and decay rate and that sort of thing. Here are the parameters for the various things. Notice that they have intervals, our way of dealing with some of the untidy aspects of the literature. Here's a typical place where some of those came from. These show the decay rates of the very short-term visual memory and the very short-term auditory memory. I believe we were the first, maybe only, people ever to discover that if you plotted the data in semi-log coordinates after subtracting the right constant from them in the right way, they form a series of straight lines, and hence you can characterize the data by half-life parameter of exponential decay, and so you can get a very simple description of what's otherwise rather complicated data. This is playing the same game for the decay of working memory or short-term memory. With a model human processor, you could do a number of simple calculations. We were supposed to be working on the office of the future. And now in the office of the future, when everybody had a desk on their computer, obviously the sort of task they would be doing with that would be video games. This shows a game that just happened to be around Park at the time. And so a typical problem is that you compute with this model is, given that one ball bumps into another, how much time do you have to compute the trajectory and start moving the second ball and still make it appear as if the collision of the one caused the second one? Well, the model human processor says that everything that happens within roughly a tenth of a second will be fused in a single percept. But a tenth of a second is sort of the limit of this phenomenon when it breaks down. And one reason for including these intervals in there is that there's various secondary effects that would actually depend on how bright the CRT is and all of that sort of stuff. If you want to be absolutely sure, you take the lower bound of that, which in this case is 50 milliseconds. Here's a piece of data that just happened to be around the literature on that topic. The axis on the bottom is in sort of strange units, I think, because it's French data. So you see, in for the region that's less than 50 milliseconds, everybody says it's immediate causality. For the region above 100 milliseconds, 150 milliseconds, everybody says that the two things are independent events, and then you get intermediate opinions in the middle of that. Well, we also did some more serious calculations. We derived from the model a calculation of what the maximum velocity is for the mouse for use in the design of the star product. And we could show that if you measure the longest distance that you're ever going to make the mouse travel, which is obviously the diagonal on the screen, you just take that number and multiply it by that number in centimeters, multiply it by 4.9, and you get the peak velocity in centimeters per second. And you could convert that into the number of mouse clicks that you were going to get, and that sets as a way of sizing the electronic circuits. It turned out the circuits were too slow, and so as a consequence of this, they were redesigned. There's many mice on the mice systems on the market today, which in fact have this error buried in them is that they limit out. So it's not an entirely obvious pitfall to avoid. Well, the model human processor also contains, as one of its principles, Herb Simon's principle of bounded rationality. It basically says that somebody does the rational things to obtain their goals bounded by limits on what they know and what sort of information that they can process. Well, we expected that from studies of problem solving, this sort of principle leads to heuristic search as a typical way in which people solve problems. We expected when we came to Park and looked at people that this is what it would actually look like. But there's two early decisions we made led us to results which were contrary to that. The first one, as Al said, is we decided to study text editing. The second one is that we decided to use expert subjects so we could get more stable data. And I'd like to show you some fragments of videotape from our experiment to sort of, first to give you a flavor of what the experiments were like. And secondly, because it turns out that 10 years after the fact, my subject list actually reads like a who's who in personal workstations and computer science, and so Tom and I have kind of the only film records of people at Park actually doing work, as opposed to the many films you've seen where they just pose for demos. So could we roll the videotape, please? Here's Ralph Kimball, the designer of the star. Larry Tesler. Larry was famous for typing with two fingers, one finger for every key on the board except the letter A and the other for the letter A. And he can do that at 40 words a minute. Jim Mitchell.
I have a question.
John Wick, one of the executives in OSC. He's saying, I can't hear the disc. Dan Swinehart, when he had a beard.
Oh, damn, that's a bug.
He found a bug in the middle of the experiment, and in the middle of my experiment, he goes off to fix the bug.
Bill was the ace programmer for Engelbart. Smokey Wallace.
Do those edits?
Another one of Engelbart's ace programmers.
Okay, you have a typo in this first thing here too.
He's a psycholinguist, he found the typos. This is Terry Winograd doing a typing test. He's typing over 100 words a minute.
And I noticed it's 13th already, so good thing I typed it out.
This is Danny Barber.
Pretty simple arithmetic problems. And this is going to be kind of a calculator jogging experience.
Ed McCright. Joe Mallison, who is it?
I know how to do that.
Burt Sutherland.
Request for Alto Capital.
Bob Taylor. We have everybody. Peter Deutsch.
Do I do only the first one or the whole thing? But that will take me 3 days.
I should say a word about Juliana. Juliana is a librarian at Park all during this period. Is one of the unsung heroes at Park. For us, she somehow managed to get hold of reams and reams of papers and books and all sorts of obscure things that we asked for, and actually materially changed the research that we would have been able otherwise to do. Well, we applied we looked at the behavior here, and it turned out that we didn't see heuristic search at all, and it was obvious after the fact. People, the tasks weren't problematic. People had built up large repertoires of methods that could be applied to the task. This wasn't problem solving, and we came to call it cognitive skill. And set out to build models to characterize and predict this mode of behavior. And the class of models that we did are called GOMS models, where we wrote down formal descriptions of goals, operators, methods, and ways of selecting among the methods that the different subjects had. Here's a fragment of a model for text editing. In order to test these models, we ran a number of experiments, and the most interesting result of that was we tried to figure out what level of detail to model people's behavior. Did it matter? How good could we get if we went down to really itsy-bitsy fine detail? And so we took the same set of data, and I can't believe we did this now, but we went over 12 times and did 12 different models at finer and finer levels of detail of the same data to see how the accuracy would improve. The accuracy didn't improve. It just stayed the same. It wasn't bad, but it never got better. The more detail you did, that was the bad news. But the good news of that was that really it didn't matter which level of detail, below a certain level, you did the modeling. And we could use that piece of information to get a kind of engineering model out of this. That led to the keystroke level model. And the keystroke level model is a kind of engineered version of this that you can write on the back of a business card. You see there's only about 5 parameters in it. There's actually some tables out of which you can extract these. Things for keystrokes and pointing and homing your hand and that sort of stuff. And some rules for when to put in mental pauses. This is a typical analysis of a task, some method for doing a task in Bravo, and you would code the actions that you had to do in terms of actions of the model. Then you would substitute in the times from all of those and come up with some prediction. Here's a comparison of 2 different methods available in some systems, showing they have very different time profiles as a function of the number of words back that you had to modify something. Well, we were more than mildly interested in whether all of this was true. So we did a fairly extensive set of experiments in which we looked at text editors, graphics editors, and various kinds of systems things that you did on the system, including dialing up the system on the telephone to log in and all of that sort of thing. And I'd like to show you a couple fragments from that so you can see what it's like. Could I have the next videotape segment, please? Okay. Here's Dave Smith, another one of the star designers, with the YOS editor. Here's Ed Taft, dialing up the terminal to log in. Here's William Newman, the designer of markup, on markup. Here's Severo Ornstein, and Sill.
Can I just buzz along through all of these?
That's right.
Okay.
and there's, of course, Butler Lampson, who then proceeded to buzz through this task, leaving the keyboard practically in flames. We've been criticized some in the literature because the times that we measure in our experiments turn out to be somewhat faster than the ones that other people when they replicate them. And we suspect that may be one of the reasons is the subjects that we had. How well did this fit? Could I have a slide, son, please? It fit reasonably well. This is the observed time versus the predicted time for the experiments. We went on to the keystroke model actually proved useful in real system design. In the Xerox Star system, for example, it was used in the now somewhat notorious decision for choosing the two-button mouse, how many buttons the mouse should have. Irby and friends wanted the fewest number of buttons that they could possibly get away with on the mouse. The idea was to make it easy to learn, and so they had about a dozen schemes for selecting text. And it was easy to see, and they needed to know something about users' performance on all of these schemes. And that was easy to do for naive users. Everybody on a new system that doesn't exist before is a naive user. So they could just measure in simple experiments the naive users. But how do you measure expert users? And after all, most people will be expert users after a short time in this kind of system. Well, the solution was to use a keystroke level model to predict the data for the expert users. And so the keystroke level model kind of allowed us to carry through, at least in some instance, a part of our original vision of packaging psychological knowledge into a model and handing it off to a designer to actually make real design decisions with. Well, eventually, starting after 1978, we put the various of these results into a book. That book contained mainly the main line of this sort of research, but there were also several other lines that weren't represented concerning learning and users' mental models of the systems that they were in. And Tom's going to tell you about those now.
Okay, let me pick up the story here with our work on what we would call the conceptual interface, which deals with the notion of mental models. The notion of a mental model, Stu has been talking about models of the user, which are our performance models. Those are models that a designer or an analyst has in their head about how the user works. A mental model is a model that we postulate that the user has in his head about how the system works, okay? And actually, the notion of a mental model is really a figment of a cognitive psychologist's imagination. That's what it's the best we can do to imagine what a person has in their head when they somehow understand what a system is doing and how to operate it beyond just being able to execute a bunch of procedures in kind of a rote kind of way, okay? Now, right from the start, when we first arrived at Park early in 1974, we began talking about this notion of the conceptual understanding a user would have, as well as the performance characteristics, such as the speed with which you would interact with the system. However, back then we referred to it as the user's model of the system. However, we weren't really able to develop a satisfactory methodology for going after this concept. And so it remained a kind of a vague notion for a while. But I think it was actually significant that a couple years later, in 1976, as the System Development Division was being spawned and the technology was being transferred out of Park into that division to develop office systems out of the Park technology, a committee was formed, headed by Charles Irby, that was supposed to lay out a strategy for how to do the user interface design. As Butler has kind of laid out for you, that the interface work at Park was basically helter-skelter, except for the Smalltalk work. But if you add the Smalltalk work, it's yet one more piece. And it's obvious if you're going to market a product, you wanted to pull it all together. So in fact, the user interface strategy was a significant thing to deal with. And a committee was formed to kind of lay out the user interface design for this. Well, the committee was headed by, as I said, Charles Irby, and include William Newman, Larry Tesler. I was on it, and a few other people. And Allen and Butler were advisors and participated in it to some extent. And actually, it was fairly widely known about. What was important was that the committee didn't go out to actually set out to try to design the system, or to lay out design principles, but really backed off and said that really what you want to do is lay out a methodology or a discipline, how to approach doing the design to pull this all together. And I think, to just be very brief about it, what was significant was that the way the methodology was laid out was that it was kind of a series of representations for how you represent the design of the interface. How do you think about it? How do you pull it together? And the four parts there were kind of, you start off with an analysis of the task that has to be done, and then, in some sense, the real creative part was to invent a conceptual model, a user's model, around which the system would be built, and then you invent kind of command or input languages and output languages to convey that. Okay, so what I want to emphasize was kind of the central role that the notion of the user's model played. Now, I think what was important about this committee is it did, I think, bring together consensus from all the user interface designers in Park and SDD for how to go about this. I think this was a widely shared point of view that this was a good way to go approaching the design. And in fact, the user interface design group in SDD followed this methodology, took it actually very seriously, and really believed in it. And I think it's one of the real reasons for the success of the user interface work that has come out of Xerox. There's another little lesson here, is part of the vision that Stu and I and Alan had about creating a kind of a calculational model that you could actually hand off to the designer so that they could actually calculate, just like an engineer might calculate using physical principles from some kind of appropriately formulated physical models. It can't always hold if you can't kind of characterize your understanding into actual calculational models. What, even though the user's model notion or the conceptual model notion was very vague, at least it was an important orienting concept. And I think what it did was gave the designers some tools for helping them kind of put themselves into the kind of eyes or into the head of the user and seeing the system from the user's point of view. That seems to be one of the real problems that we have with designers. And so, in fact, just at this level of connection with design, it seemed like a very important thing to have done. Well, it turns out that I'm not going to go into the mental model's results. I'll just mention a couple, I think, of interesting things. Was that it wasn't until later, like I think it was almost 1979, that we actually began to run some empirical studies to see if, in fact, this figment of imagination of about a mental model really existed. And we actually studied several people around Park in detailed interviews and questionnaires that tried to evoke them to explain what was going on. And we tried to see if we could discover whether people had reasonable models of how the system was operating. And we did this on the base of the Alto executive, basically the Alto environment, the operating environment, okay? And much to our surprise, we found that there were many people who, if you walked up to, you would declare was a very competent users who obviously got work done every day. The Altos were pervasive by this time, and everybody was using for their daily work. Many of these users had absolutely no idea what was going on inside the system. They had a lot of procedures for how to proceed, and they could get a lot of tasks done, but they had very little understanding. Subsequently, we felt like we had to resuscitate this concept. It seemed very important. And so we actually did a whole line of experimental work trying to understands whether giving a person a mental model would actually make a difference in their thinking about the system. And we had kind of boiled down the problem to kind of the simplest essence and took kind of, I think, the purest manifestation of a conceptual model of any system that I know, and that's the stack calculator model that one gets with, for example, an HP calculator. And we actually ran experiments comparing groups that were given this model and taught it explicitly and other groups that weren't, and then we did a lot of analysis of it. We were able to revive our faith in that concept and show that, in fact, giving a person an appropriate kind of model in certain kinds of circumstances, and it's too complicated to go into now, really does make a difference. Okay, and so I think it just kind of goes back and justifies that methodology, which says the conceptual model is kind of a central organizing theme around which you build an interface. I think it's still right. Okay, let me then just close out with the last topic here, which is what we call the task interface, and it says they're pondering ideas. We had to get the pondering somehow, and by that we meant this is our current work. This is what we're currently interested in. Okay, how do we take all the kind of understanding that we have, and how are we going to push forward? And so I'm just going to say a few words about kind of the kind of things we're looking at now, and kind of what we see is kind of the interesting problems in the immediate future. So we're interested now in augmenting very complex intellectual tasks, things that go under the kind of broad terms of authoring, design, analysis, research. Okay, and at one level, I mean, we're back to taking another run at the grand vision of Licklider, Engelbart, and all these things we've heard in the last couple days. We are kind of upping our sights and trying to address kind of the larger scale intellectual tasks as opposed to the smaller scale kind of unit tasks that, what we called unit tasks in our earlier work, which are kind of the component tasks that made up the fine level skills that we had been studying. Okay, and this is kind of involving a shift in our research strategy, where now we're interested in studying basically the nature of kind of a complex task. How do the small tasks add up to do a large piece of interesting work over large periods, numbers of days and months? We're now in the process of actually building systems that we actually use and can study users on, as opposed to our earlier strategy, which was we were incredibly conservative and we only studied users of systems that others had built than the systems that had been around. We basically stayed out of and backed off from kind of the main line of work in PARC and kind of took a stand back role and observed what was going on with some of these new systems, but we didn't directly participate in development of that. I think, in retrospect, that was exactly the right thing to have done in order to begin to lay the base and kind of concretize this vision of what an applied or a science base might be about. Okay, but now we're kind of emerging out of that phase and now more directly participating in developing systems as we try to push our understanding of the user. And of course, what we're trying to do is develop new user interface principles and models of how users behave. Okay, so the tack we're taking is to develop some exploratory systems that help people with basically what we might now call idea processing tasks. Okay, how to help people deal with the complex of ideas. And the main trick here seems to be that we want to help people externalize their ideas so, in fact, they can deal with them. And for purposes of this talk, let's break it into two parts. And Stu and I are each kind of more focused on each of us on one of these. And the first problem you get if you're trying to externalize the ideas people want to deal with in their heads is, first of all, that you have to help them express and represent these ideas. And from on this, we're drawing on notions from artificial intelligence and cognitive science on knowledge representation. And then we have the problem of how the user can assimilate and manipulate idea structures or ideas, and we're drawing on ideas of computer graphics. And these two things, of course, go hand in hand. These are not really independent problems at all. And what we're really looking for is to identify and to characterize in these larger tasks what are the key constraints, as Stu mentioned before, the cognitive limitations that's really holding back the computer from being a really useful tool from in working on these tasks. And for example, one obvious cognitive constraint is the limited amount of working memory that one has in dealing with any task. That's just a bottleneck that limits the complexity of things you can deal with. And so, for example, the attack on representation is a well-known technique from cognitive psychology that, in fact, if you want to increase your working memory capacity, you have to recode, or psychologists are in chunk, the things you want to deal with into larger and larger units. And that's one of the functions that the new representations will allow you to do. And then, secondly, we want to use the display itself as an extension of our internal working memory, as a kind of a coordinated external memory that will work with it. Well, let me just take the two parts of that, and then we can close up with a closing remark. In the attack on trying to develop representations, we're really focused on a large-scale generic class of tasks, which let me call authoring. And for example, historical analysis might be, as I was happy to hear Gordon Bell mention, an interesting instance of this kind of a task. What workstations have done up to now and what they've focused on is really the final product. I mean, how do we get everything up on the display? Basically, how do we get the words, the graphics? Basically, it's the final product of the whole effort. The problem is that one doesn't walk up to a computer and want to think with it. One wants to go up and finally do the composition, compose the final product. We're trying to push back that barrier to where let's say I'm doing historical analysis, I'm starting off with some sources of information. I might want to collect some notes or ideas about that. I then want to put some structure on those things, do some analyses. I may want to sort of find some coherence, get some situational models that characterize what's going on. I may then develop points of view about what's going on. I may want to create some arguments for why I believe that or don't believe that. I may then want to, the notion of a rhetorical plan, I want to tell an audience or convince an audience about it, so I have to develop a plan for convincing that particular audience, and then I'm ready to, let's say, outline the paper and then write. The problem is that how do we get people, when they're at this phase, when their ideas are very vague and they haven't really come together, how can we get the computer to really help them? How can they be sitting at a terminal and not off in the shower when they're at that phase? And so that's the challenge that we're trying to push. The way we're going about that is we're building an exploratory system which we call note cards, and it's built in Interlisp on our current workstations. And the idea of the system is, it's, as you can imagine, it's an electronic analog of physical note cards, except they're all linked together in ways that seeing Doug Engelbart's thing is very much in the same spirit. And we're trying to build these systems to be usable enough so, in fact, we can put them into the hands of people who have real problems and try to develop some generic representations for helping them deal with them in interesting ways. And let me just give you a couple of examples and show you some of the problems that really come out of trying to use a system like this. Here's an example of a first cut at somebody trying to develop a tableau for organizing a set of decisions in creating online instructional modules. Okay, so here's a series of decisions. Here's a series of instructional principles. Here's some statements of of the goal of the instructional module, and down here in the middle are some rationale relating these decisions to the principles and to the objectives. Okay, so what you see in a system like this is you're really encouraged to put massive amounts of information up on a screen in the form of independent little windows, and of course that can get very confusing. Here's another example of another kind of person who is a lawyer trying to develop some representations of the structure of a legal brief, okay, so that in fact one can prepare and analyze the arguments in a legal brief and basically help with that fairly complex argumentation task, okay. And what you saw there was not only the note cards themselves coming up, but kind of overview structures, which are important in building various kinds of views of what's going on. Which then leads, of course, to the other half of the problem, that if you're going to deal with large amounts of idea structures, in fact, when there's a large number, it's just very difficult to grasp. And in these kind of complex tasks, you just want to deal with large numbers. Otherwise, it isn't really a very interesting task. And we find that the current metaphors we have in user interface design, such as the desktop metaphor, have obvious limits to them. And anybody who's used the system, I think, understands this. For example, here, to give you a picture of that, Stu has done a little analysis of treating windows as a working set, just and very much an analogy to how one would analyze paging in a virtual memory, okay? And so we're viewing this screen as the memory and the windows, the information in the windows as the pages, okay? And here is a snapshot from a segment of behavior of a programmer debugging a complex Lisp program, okay? In InnerLisp, which has enormous numbers of windows, and you can see kind of the working set varying over time as he's doing the task. And you can imagine that the green line up there might be the constraints of a screen of a certain size. So let's say that the screens we typically deal with, 17-inch screens, maybe can hold about 8 windows at a time. So that when you reach certain points in the task, you're going to have to spend time going and getting new information. Okay, if you were to do the same kind of task, let's say on a max size screen, which is more of this the red line level of capacity, obviously you're going to be thrashing like mad. It's basically an undoable task if you want to do it in that way. Okay. So the problem is that techniques that we know today, at least many of them, just don't scale up. Those node-link graphs like I showed you on there, they scale up a little farther, but you hit limits with them. It's clear we have to explore new kinds of techniques for kind of pushing the limits and of the complexity of things that we can grasp. And some of the techniques we're looking into, for example, are the notion of distorted views, that if I'm viewing a complex structure, I don't necessarily have to view it all at the same level of detail. I can blow up certain parts that I'm interested in, blow down, and make very condensed other parts. This is sometimes called fisheye views, kind of with an analogy to a fisheye lens, which focuses you a very large at what's at the center and then fades off and squeezes everything around it. Okay, and another technique is kind of dynamically being able, in an animated kind of way, to fly through the data to allow you to kind of spatial integration mechanisms to build up a sense of the whole. Okay, and so what we're doing for that is building a system which combines the dandelion, the Lisp on the dandelion, with the Silicon Graphics Iris terminal, which gives us a lot of hardware for doing dynamic graphics and trying to explore these kind of techniques. So those are the kind of the problems we're looking for, and we think that's kind of where we're trying to kind of push the next set of understandings about how we can overcome some of the limitations and help the users. So let me just wrap up with a final remark. Stu introduced this notion of a user technology, okay, which is maybe a slightly different cast on the notion of a personal workstation technology. It says that the technology is not just this big tidal wave of advancing technology, but is a technology that's kind of centered around trying to help the users. And as Stu said, I mean, there's at least, well, he put it in two parts, but let me just say it in three parts. There's at least three parts to this user technology. First of all, there's the technology of the physical workstation itself and the devices that go with it. Then there's the art artistic component. There's the art of user interface design, and user interface design really is an art. And I think it's not really, it wouldn't be stretching things very much to say that many of the people that we've dealt with at Park in the last few years are really user interface artists. And then finally, there's the science component that builds up a base of understanding of the user, and that's the part that Stu and I have been mostly focused on. Although the workstation has really grown up and flowered in the last, let's say, 10 or 12 years, the field of understanding it is kind of lagging a little bit. Stu and I were in the game very early. We started in 1974, and Alan had the vision, 3 years before that. As of about 4 or 5 years ago, a field is beginning to build up around human-computer interaction. And in fact, today there are annual conferences run by the ACM. There's 4 or 5 journals devoted, specialty journals devoted to this area. And there must be 20 or 25 at least programs in various departments of universities centered on this issue. And so, in fact, there's a lot of people now beginning to focus on this problem. This seems very appropriate, because if you think of the kind of the tidal wave of technology advancing, what it's really doing is opening us up opportunities and relaxing a lot of the constraints we had in dealing with people, and more focuses on the question to what do people really need. And so the notion of a user science, I think, becomes more and more relevant and more important.
And I'll just make one remark, and then if there's any questions you want. I know this is something Tom wanted to say because we talked about it before, but to simply observe that there is, in fact, a connection between the note cards thing that he was describing and the Zog program that I made a remark and the promise thing. And in fact, there is actually a strong linear thread that runs through all of that that really does address Jan's comment about those coming back together. Are there any comments or questions that anyone would like to put to? Yes.
I'm really thrilled. That's just marvelous. And my only question is to the rest of the world: why aren't there just about 20 times or 100 times that many people working on this side of the issue? It's weighted so heavily on the technology, the hardware and software side, and this is a side that has to grow to make it work. And it's long overdue and good for you. And then while you're at it, answer for Jan and me: how long does it take a person to learn to use a mouse? To go from Rhapsody to something small and practical?
Well, he's coming up, I'll answer the first half. No, and then you can answer the second half. The first half is an analog of Butler's comment that building interfaces is hard. Doing science about them is harder, it turns out, if you really want to do good science of the attempt. The kind of thing that Tom was talking about, which again begins to be very qualitative, is kind of a momentary extrapolation off of doing a fair amount of effort down at the level that we've talked about, where you finally get some kind of models. And one can only go so far before one has to keep building that science base. And that does, in fact, go very slowly and is very hard to do. And there's lots of people in psychology who don't quite have the vision that it ought to be that kind of an engineering science. Do you want to?
I can't give you a real data answer to it, but it turns out that the important thing to look at is the distribution of times it takes people to learn the mouse, because there's a lot of people who sort of learn it in a minute. But when you take this thing out into the real world of offices, you find there's a small percentage of people, 2-3%, who never really do quite get the hang of the mouse, who otherwise have some fairly strange characteristics. We found that the person who's in charge of customer training for Xerox, she came over and was trying to show me how to do something. Turns out she holds her mouse upside down. somebody who worked with me recently made another mouse especially for women with long fingernails. It has this kind of fenders on it so you don't scrape your fingernails. So there is this residual of people. We found another application in which people didn't like the mouse at all. BB&N was doing a study for the Social Security Administration. And these Social Security reps have fairly
a fair number of hard luck customers who come in, and it turned out they didn't like the mouse at all because the mouse has a cord that is that a one of their patients could wrap around their neck. And so so most people, you know, 5 minutes will do it, but there's this residual.
Sig Troy. I'd like to identify what I consider to be really the most significant contribution that this particular group has made, Stu Card and Tom Moran and Al Newell. And I am doing that from my personal vantage point and based on my experiences and having tried to look at this sort of interdisciplinary area of computer science and psychology for quite a few years. And the fact of the matter is, and this is partly in response to what Doug was just commenting on, the fact of the matter is that in many computer science departments over the years, there was a certain aversion. Indeed, you might almost call it a looking down upon someone who was willing to engage in something as subjective and you know, vague, et cetera, as the user psychology and so on. There were much more exciting, deterministic, and precise kinds of things to attend to in the area of hardware and software and so on than to look at user psychology of all crazy things. And I feel that this group at Park, with a very supportive and respected kind of environment that they've been able to enjoy, have sort of put that area on the map. And I can assure you that as a result, I can see in my own department, and I'm speaking from personal experience again, I can see a recognition that sure enough, there must be something to that. And it's not as though computer scientists are somehow deluding themselves or what by looking at the user psychology side of things. So I think it's a very welcome kind of trend, and I think for the historical record, that should be viewed as an important contribution. Thanks.
I'd just like to add a few comments about the work in Xerox SDD and the design of STAR. I'm Charles Irby. I was charged by Xerox with the responsibility of overseeing the design of the functionality and the user interface for STAR. And what we did, basically, following this interdisciplinary group that was set up that Tom described, is we actually took our design group out into the field. We got our product planning people to actually identify target office environments. And I took the designers out there and had them sit for about a 2-day period with these people to understand the tasks that they did. That was the task part of this little model that Tom described. We then came back and put a very large emphasis on the whole notion of a conceptual model, the objects that are dealt with in these tasks, the operations you can apply to those objects when doing the task. We had about half of my group doing design prototypes. They're actually doing software implementations, working right along with the designers on a day-to-day basis, and trying things all along. We set up a laboratory down in Los Angeles, staffed by a variety of people, some of which were psychology people, some of which were engineering people. And we actually brought subjects in and tested various aspects of these user interfaces, tested parts of the conceptual model to make sure that our understanding was correct. And we changed quite a bit of the design as a result of that work. And then finally, we produced a rather substantial document called the STAR Functional Specification that described the entire user interface in great detail. And it was entirely organized on the basis of this conceptual model, the objects that were dealt with and the actions that could be applied to those objects, with a great deal of illustration showing exact pictures of the user interface as it should look all through the course of these operations. So I just want to substantiate what Stu and Tom have been talking about. This work has been very important inside Xerox. The discipline was applied quite sternly within the design group, and I think the payoff was very large.
Doug Ross, I just wanted, with regard to the last part of your presentation, with respect to how to have mental models and expressing them in ways that are suitable to these display techniques that are now available, just call to your attention my own structured analysis and design technique, which is now about a dozen years old, been very heavily used, is very successful for those who do use it. Most recent descriptions of it have appeared in the IEEE Computer Magazine, both an article in, I think it was April, and an interview with me in June or July issue. And I'm very much hopeful that, although it's had a history of lacking the graphic tools to go with the mental discipline and the paper and pencil and making lots of Xerox copies in the past, that it will start to serve some of these functions. Like many of our things, it seems to have been a few years before its time. And we think that the time is about right now for it to start fulfilling this role of being, if you will, a more disciplined and rigorous and structured way of doing the same sorts of things as your note cards are intended to do.
Oh, there's one more. Last one.
Hi, Bruce Tognazzini, Apple Computer. We're the ones who perfected the mouse by getting rid of those extra buttons. I keep your book open on my desk all the time showing the chart which shows that the mouse is superior to function keys and cursor keys because of the parade of people through my office attempting to add function keys and cursor keys. There seems to be a difference between the subjective time of the person using the computer and the objective time showed by a videotape wherein the mouse is proven superior. How do you deal with people who decide because of the subjective time that the mouse is the inferior device? How do you convince these people? In other words, it's one thing to prove it through cognitive psychology, but how do you motivate through motivational psychology that in fact the mouse is the superior device?
Well, whether the mouse is superior or not depends so heavily on how it's used. I'm always astonished at how you can take a very good interface technique and completely botch up an interface by using it too much or the wrong way. And the mouse is certainly one of those. In fact, many interfaces we run on right now, there's such a love affair with the mouse that it's used for both the argument that you're selecting and the command, say, on a pop-up window that you're doing. And so you end up having to go back and forth and back and forth with the mouse. There's one of these interfaces, a calendar system, I once did an analysis of, and I discovered that by using a mouse, they managed to make it take four times as long as it would have taken had you used keys alone. And you actually have to do a much broader analysis. The reason that the mouse worked for Doug's system is that they had the other hand doing the functional keys, and they didn't, so they could kind of keep from overloading any one thing. You know, interfaces really take four hands to operate, and it's unfortunate that people don't come with four hands. Otherwise, it would just be wonderful. It takes one hand kind of for doing the functional thing, one hand for doing the mouse, and then two hands for typing in on the keyboard. And you can look at various interfaces as ways of compromising and getting the number of hands down. Bravo, for example, used modes. So you were either in insertion mode or command mode, and that made the interface only take three hands. So you got rid of the function keys, and there's other ones that compromise in various ways. I don't know if that answered your question directly, but I think that it, when you try and tell people, oh, the mouse is better than this in the abstract, that's not as powerful as if you look at the particular ecological circumstances. The mouse is better in this particular circumstance because this hand isn't doing anything and it's overloaded and there aren't very many of these and that sort of thing.
I do have one other very quick question since
okay,
I think
that's the last question.
I think we have the right people in the room. I'd really like to know what the plural of mouse is. Mises.
There aren't any systems that have more than one mouse.
Did this come off?
Can I make a quick comment?
Sure, make a quick comment.
Yeah, I think it's not just the context that's important, but
what's
also...
What's your name?
Oh, Mark Richer, Stanford. Not just the context is important, but the person. And I hope that that the computer companies will support all the input devices. I'll give you an example. I know a disabled programmer who's a Macintosh programmer, and he can't use the mouse, but the head device he can use. So I think if you keep that in mind, maybe we'll stop having religious arguments about these devices.
I don't know anyone of the people who are sort of mouse aficionados, like Engelbart and English and me to a certain extent, are probably the least religious people about the mouse. Along with them, I sort of see it as a provisional device that you might be able to do better than in some circumstances. You're not going to beat the speed with those muscles, but there are other ways. And so for a person with a particular handicap, for example, there obviously is going to be better ways. For a particular kind of interface, like the promise system, there's particular things about that might make the touch technology better.
I really lost. It turns out I let it happen. In a historical conference, we got a mice conversation going.